And this exercise or example is going to be important for simulation. Let X be a continuous random variable. With Cdf capital F sub X of little x. And suppose I've got a new random variable. I'm going to call it U instead of Y this time. That equals capital F sub X of capital X. I guess I'm calling these exercises because I'm ultimately asking them as questions. The question is, what is the distribution of U? Yeah, so this is these two exercises are examples of transformations, transform random variables, which the book does talk about to some degree at the end of chapter 4. And I did put it on Moodle, though kind of late. I put it early this morning on Moodle to read the end of chapter 4 as well as chapter 5. I should have done that earlier. At the end of chapter 4, there's a section about, well, there's two sections that we don't cover in problem stats. Actually three sections we don't cover. There's one about transformations of random variables and another about simulation. The one about simulation is much shorter. The transformation is kind of long, kind of confusing. What I'm showing you here in these exercises is kind of the heart of that section about transformations, but I'm doing it in really what's an easier way. The harder way, a bit more confusing, involves derivatives in the abstract, derivatives of inverse functions, in fact. I am using derivatives like I did here to find a PDF, and I will do here as well, but I'm not stating the method in kind of an abstract way, which is the confusing part. I'm doing really what you would call the CDF method. Let's first find the CDF of U. Just like I started this example by finding the CDF of Y. Not saying what X is. So whatever I'm about to do is going to be an abstract thing because I'm not specifying what capital F is. The CDF of capital U, I could call a capital F sub U of, say, little u. By definition, as always, the CDF is the probability that the random variable is less than or equal to the given number. That's always the case. This is essential to realize this week. Today and Thursday, we're going to use this idea a number of times, and it'll probably go into next week some too. All right, what do you do with this? Again, here's how the light bulb goes off in your head. I better use what I'm assuming. I'm supposing U equals that. I better use that somehow. How? Well, I guess the only thing to do is replace the U with this CDF of capital X evaluated at capital X. Replace U with that. I guess that's the only thing you can do. Where in the world am I going with this? Got any bright ideas? What did I do in the last one? the last exercise, I was to this point here. And then I essentially tried to rewrite the inequality in terms of Z to help me use the capital phi, like Cdf of a standard normal. Could I do something similar here in the abstract? Could I, for example, somehow isolate capital X? Get rid of the capital F sub X somehow, sort of? No ideas? It's abstract. Could I do something like this? And if so, what would I put there? U? The answer is no. I would not put little u, though it would involve a little u. No ideas? When you try to solve an equation like this, e to the x equals 5, what do? Take the natural log of both sides, right? Ln of e to the x equals ln of 5. In other words, x equals ln of 5. What's the relationship between e to the x and natural log of x? They are inverses, inverse functions. You could pretend capital F and maybe is e to the x or something, maybe. It wouldn't be actually, but to get x isolated, you would take the natural log, the inverse function of both sides of the inequality. Yeah, that's what we do in the abstract. Write a capital F sub x over here, but with an inverse symbol. That's not negative one power, that's inverse function. But wait a minute, can I really do that? Does F inverse exist? How do I know it exists? Wouldn't capital F sub X have to be 1-to-1? 1-to-1. Is it? It actually depends on what the CDF is, actually. CDFs, remember, are always non-decreasing functions. Sometimes they're always strictly increasing, but sometimes they can be constant for a while. Well, let's not worry about it too much. Let's just assume we're kind of in the case where the graph of a CDF is always strictly increasing. So you'd have to think about the technicalities of whether this would really work in the case where capital F is sometimes constant, which it can be. And just pretend its graph is always going up. Assuming capital F sub X is monotone increasing. It's certainly non-decreasing. It doesn't go down in value, but it can stay constant sometimes for a while. And assuming if it's monotone increasing, then the inverse function is going to exist. And what's going on here? Hey, wait a minute. What's the CDF of capital X? The CDF of capital X, by definition, capital F sub X of little x is the probability that capital X is less than or equal to little x. That's the CDF of X. See the similarity there? P of X less than or equal to something. This is a value of capital F sub X. What value? Capital F sub X of whatever's over there. I guess that's capital F sub X inverse of U. But wait a minute, fx and fx inverse are inverses. This gives you u. Hey, that's pretty simple. And what's the PDF of u? It's derivative. Little f sub u of little u is the derivative of capital F sub u of little u. And that's going to be one. Wait a minute, how can a PDF always equal one? Can a PDF always equal one? It's a bit of a trick question. Can it be a horizontal line for its graph? Yeah, as long as it's only one for a limited range of values, like from 3 to 4, from 7 to 8. In fact, it would have to be a 1-unit interval of values, 0 to 1 maybe. And actually, in doing this calculation, since capital U is the CDF of capital X evaluated at capital X, capital X can take on any real value possibly, but U can only take on values between 0 and 1. CDFs do have to be between 0 and 1, right? Their outputs have to be between 0 and 1. You know, a typical kind of graph of a CDF might look like this. At least if it's monotone increasing. Might look like that. And the outputs are between 0 and 1. They have to approach 1 as the input goes to infinity. U has to be between 0 and 1. Little u has to be between 0 and 1 here. I'll put less than or equal to's. But I could have put strict inequalities. Less than's. Doesn't matter with continuous. And yeah, this u's, hey, that's why I called it u. It's a uniform random variable. Uniform distribution. You had an exercise about uniform distributions over the interval from A to B, right? The graph of little f is up at 1 when u is between 0 and 1 and is 0 elsewhere. And again, it doesn't matter whether I have open circles down on the axis and closed circles up on top or open circles on top and closed circles on the bottom. Doesn't matter. It's a continuous random variable, so you're never going to observe a value of exactly 0 or exactly 1 anyway, right? These things are models of reality, so rounding, you could round to 0 or round to 1, but in terms of real numbers that have infinitesimal expansions that go on forever and ever, getting exactly 0 or exactly 1 is impossible. Getting exactly any value is impossible, which again, that's the paradox. But of course, we do observe values, but they're really rounded values. So they're really values with a margin of error. It's confusing, yes. Try to dispel the confusion by talking about it again every so often. So the result is that for any random variable X whose CDF at least is monotone increasing, U is going to be uniform 0, 1. Now I could write U of 0, 1, but that would be confusing. Maybe I should do UINF 0, 1. What if the CDF of X was not monotone strictly increasing? What if it's constant sometimes? Well, then it's not so clear if this is going to work. But maybe it sort of works still. Maybe. Not going to worry about it at the moment.